come back to this palatability puzzle and look at how we can make each one of these pieces of the puzzle either positive or negative based on how we manage animals. So these are the pre-harvest factors. I'm going to first talk about animal aid. So we know we have a quality grading system in beef that segments animals based on the physiological injury. It's related to chronological, but it's not 100% because we're looking at bone ossification, how those animals actually age. So let's look at what happens as animals get older. And let me put this, I didn't realize I put those in different order. I want to put them in the same order as I have the slides, okay? This is connective tissue. And this is contractile. So what happens when animals age to each of the pieces of the four puzzle? As animals age, does it affect marbling? And old animals can marble just as well as young animals, but they have to be fed a high plane of nutrition, they have to hit the fattening phase, and they have to have enough nutrition for a long enough period of time to deposit fat. We tend to not feed our older animals in that way because older animals, C, D, and E animals, are used for beef trimmings. Some of the whole muscles are used for value-added cuts, but there isn't any economic incentive because trimmings cost less than whole muscle. So why would you feed them? So they can marble, but generally do not. And I had some cow steaks we used at a chef seminar, and they looked beautiful from a marbling standpoint. They were about modest 60, and they ate like cow. Because the biggest thing that affects palatability as animals get older is connective tissue. We learned a lot about that. And that's why really we have the A, B, C, D, and E in the quality grading system. Because as the animals age, we know their collagen solubility decreases, the percent solubility, the percent decreases. And that has a pretty big effect. And the reason meat from older animals is tougher is because it has less soluble collagen. That's just the bottom line. And we harvest animals in the beef industry at less than 30 months of age, on average about 16 to 20 months of age, sometimes up to 24. And so animals are pretty young. Hogs are right at the onset of puberty, so they're very young. And lambs are about the same physiologically as cattle. So as long as we use young animals, we don't have a problem. That'd be immaturity. And so some other countries have animals that are older when they go to slaughter, and they have more tenderness issues because the animals have less soluble collagen. Can't change that. Contractile state. Is the contractile state going to affect how animals age? I told you the story about when I really understood cold shortening for the first time was the cooler of animals from animals that were older. Right, C, D, and E maturity animals. Well, the reason that they cold shortened is that we're going to cut them into trim, right? And they have less fat because we're not going to feed them. They're not going to be heavier weight carcasses, and they're going to be more susceptible to cold shortening. So, as animals age, just because of the way we produce animals that are older animals are byproducts of beef production, they are more susceptible to cold shortening. But if you have young versus old animals and they're the same composition and the same pluses and minuses to look at what has the biggest impact here. But this is a fattening effect, a fattening weight effect. What about that? Those effects of aging, postpartum degradation. Do older animals not? Does their muscles not degrade? Calpostatins not work the same way? No. They're the same. Inside the muscle, they're the same. There's some other things that are different, but they still have all the proteins there to have muscle turnover, all the enzymes. So no effect. Now, if they're cold shortened, they're not going to age as well, because remember, it's going to be too crowded. So when we step back and look at what young versus old animals, so let's just put that up here. Young versus old, the positives. The biggest thing up here of the four pieces that affects it is that is connective tissue. So marbling, because young animals will tend to have more marbling than old animals. So I'm just going to put a minus. And that's more nutrition, right? Connective tissue, this young, there's five pluses, and old, they get five minuses, right? Because that's the big effect. That's a big impact. Contractile state, yeah, old animals tend to be to have shorter sarcomeres, but that's just because, again, of nutrition. And aging, no effect. So we don't have any pluses or minuses. So when you, what I want to do by the time we finish today is be able to look at all these factors and see how we drive differences in palatability. And meat from our production systems and how we can control it. And genetics. And I'm not going to do the pork. I'm just going to do beef because we talked enough about pork. I think you know those things that drive differences in pork, right? pH, water holding capacity, those kinds of things. So the question is genetics. Does genetics play a role in meat quality? If you take breeds, you have to learn heritabilities for tenderness and marbling because they're moderately heritable, meaning that through selection, we can have some influence on improving them. And if you were to compare 30 years ago to today, as far as how our industries use EPDs to select for marbling and tenderness, our animals are different. So we can have an impact. We have genetic tools now where we can take snips of hair of animals and determine if they have positive influence on tenderness or on marbling, if they have the genetic capacity to express those. So marbling, is there a genetic difference in the propensity to marble? Yes. So we know that we can select animals that have higher marbling. And if you look at the Angus breed, you know, they've gotten a reputation of, oh, that cattle need to be black to be able to marble. That's not really true, but they have put more emphasis on selection for marbling because of certified Angus and giving an economic incentive for higher marbling. So there's an incentive to select. And so in our population, if you looked at black versus other animals, that would be true. Do the other breeds have the propensity? They have animals with the propensity, but they haven't put as much selection pressure on marbling. That makes sense? Dr. Sanders should be proud of me. So, for marbling, can we select? Yes. And it's moderately heritable, and we can make progress. And we have made progress. And it used to be that we didn't have EPDs for marbling for all breeds. And if you went in and you're going to do sire selection, you wouldn't necessarily know if the bull that you're getting ready to purchase had the propensity to produce progeny that would hopefully have higher marbling scores. But we have that now, and that's a big deal. And we can also do some genetic selection with genetic markers and have an actual, a little bit better estimation. Connective tissue. Are there genetic differences in total amount of collagen solubility in animals? You don't see EPDs, do you? No. So there's no effect here. What about contractile state? Do some animals cold shorten and some animals don't because of their genetics? And since contractile state is purely a function of animal's weight and fatness and cooling, those animals that are larger and heavier, yeah, we have less cold shortening today than we did 30 years ago because we have selected for heavier animals, heavier live weights at 4/10, 3/500 of an inch of fat. So we eliminated that piece of the puzzle almost totally in the U.S. by selecting for heavier cattle. But it isn't because there's a genetic relationship, okay? So this is genetics, this is just selection for heavier weights, so has resulted in this being out of the way, all right? What about meat aging? Are there differences in calpain and calpastatin levels? Yes, and the genetic markers for tenderness are mainly selection for calpastatin. The first ones were very heavy calpastatin. Now that we have things like the 50,000, it's looking at 50,000 different components of the genome, there are more components than calpastatin. But animals that have higher calpastatin don't age as well because we have to get the calpastatin out of the way. And so if we can select for lower calpastatin, they'll age faster. They'll get into the box faster. So aging, as far as genetics, I'm going to put three pluses. So we've had the biggest impact on selecting for marbling. And that's probably more because there's an economic incentive. You always have to have an economic incentive to change things. There's still not an economic incentive for low calpastatins, all right? Other than in the Bos indicus breed, where if you have lower calpastatins and you have a lower EPD or a higher EPD for tenderness, you might get more money for your bull, all right? So when you sit back and look at the genetic puzzle, we have some effects, right? So if we keep animals young, and select for genetics, look up there at those pieces of the puzzle. We're going to have a positive impact on marbling from a genetic standpoint. Keep them young, that's gonna keep that connective tissue piece from being too big. And we aren't doing much for contractile state with age or genetics, are we? Other than selecting for heavier animals. Not a real big effect there. And aging, genetics has the biggest effect. So you see how I'm trying to work through this and really give you a good picture of what's going on? So genetics. And this is the Bos indicus versus Bos taurus. And we do know that Bos indicus influenced animals have higher calpastatin, but not all of them. The tenderness slide that I showed you where there was the F1s and then the Angus, there were 15 different Bos indicus sires into that F1 line. I didn't show you that because it looks very colorful. And there are differences in how progeny from different sires, how they age and what their calpastatin level is. And when we select for for lower calvastatin. We've been able to see those animals do age more rapidly, and they're going to age more like those Angus. Okay? So, that's the point of that slide. And then I have lots of things to show you all that. And this is that slide. See, there are all those sires. One of those sires, as you know, is an Angus sire, but the rest of them are Vos indicus. And it's kind of a mess, isn't it? Kind of bright for Wednesday morning. But when I summarize it, this the Angus, and this is over a 5-year study, so lots and lots of animals, right? And very good control on everything. And look at this sire number 2. At 1 day, certainly tougher than this group is tougher than this group, right? Now, you notice that as they age, they all decrease, don't they? But some of them decrease at different rates. So there is a genetic effect. That's all I wanted to show you with that slide. Other than the fact that I like it because it has lots of colors, all right? But genetics does affect it. What about animal sex? In the U.S., we castrate our males and we feed steers and heifers. We do not feed bulls. So if we look at heifers, steers, and bulls. So bulls would be intact and they're subsequent castrated males and then versus females for marbling. We know that bulls are going to be leaner, especially after the onset of puberty when they start showing secondary sex characteristics and we have testosterone production. So they are leaner, but they're bigger and they have less marbling. So for marbling, when we look at the sex effect, the bulls are negative, aren't they? And that's one of the things that I told Sukarni. You know, they put an automated system to measure yield grade and quality grade and measure marbling. It's like, well, that's fine, but you know, when you have traces and practically void and almost everything, is in most of your plants, you're just slaughtering Brahman bulls that have only been fed 70 days on only a 70% concentrate ration. They've been implanted twice, and in the last 45 days, they've been fed Zilmax. Yeah, marbling's not going to come with that, right? Their three-way cross heifers is a different story, but because what we find, heifers, once heifers and steers reach puberty and heifers start excreting higher levels of estrogen, they're going to fatten a little bit more rapidly. We saw that in the growth and development lecture. And so they deposit more rapidly after puberty. So I'm going to put a plus here, and this is just going to be the average. So we will tend to see, if managed exactly the same, and they're the same genetic makeup, that a heifer and a steer counterpart, the heifer is going to be a little bit fatter and have a little bit more marbling. Okay. But, you know, the biggest thing, you know, from a meat science standpoint, I know they want the growth that testosterone gives them. I'm like, you know, if all you're going to do is not worry about merchandising this as center of the plate type meat, yeah, then I wouldn't castrate either. But if you're going to spend the money and you think marbling's important, you better start castrating. At least castrate some pens and see what that does. Because you're never going to get it with those animals. Connective tissue. It's animal sex, whether we castrate or not, or heifers versus steers, or heifers versus the baseline. As long as we keep them young, we've done the best we can for collagen solubility. Heifers, as long as they don't calve, are pretty much like bulls. I mean, like steers, as far as collagen solubility. But if they've had a calf, if they've had one parturition, then they will end up, we'll see them ossify more rapidly. And most of the B-bone cattle that we have in the coolers today are from heifers who have calved or are pregnant, and their dressing percentages are off because we had a calf in there, right? Not a good thing. So heifers only if they've calved, okay? Only if they've calved. And we'll even see some of those animals get to the C maturity group when physiologically they're not old enough to be in C maturity. It's pretty interesting to watch that. So I'm going to put, this is normally a negative except calve, and then that's a negative, okay? So as long as you keep the heifers from getting pregnant, no effect. What about contractile state? Bulls are leaner, right? And their carcasses have less fat, but they're a little bit heavier. So the outside of that carcass without the fat is very, very much more susceptible to bull shortening. So what we find from a contractile state, you're going to have a negative effect of bulls. Again, steers and heifers are going to be, as long as they're heavy and they're the same weight, the same fatness, no effect. There isn't anything that says because it's a female versus a male that there's difference in contractile state. It's all based on weight and fatness and cooling temperature, cooler. Meat agings. Does meat age differently in bulls versus steers versus heifers? Dr. Brad Morgan's dissertation was, he hypothesized that bulls, because they have increased protein synthesis due to testosterone production, right? They're getting their secondary sex characteristics, they have real rapid growth, that they would have higher calvastatin. But that has never been, there is a lot of complicating factors in that, and the answer finally was no. Don't know, not fully elucidating. There is thought that there could be a difference, but as long as they're not cold shortening, there's no effect. Now, the meat from bulls may start out tougher because of other factors, and it won't age as well, but that's pretty much it. So, what you found looking at this puzzle so far is we harvest our animals young, we castrate our males, and we do genetic selection. And those things have really moved our industry. And if you look at the tenderness survey, that the first one we did in 1989, published in 1990, and it's been done every 5 years since, we've steadily, through that time, since 1990, improved tenderness and reduced variability in tenderness. It doesn't mean that there still aren't tough animals out there, but our production systems, which help us to do the positive things on that chart, have really helped us to improve the quality of our product. Now we'll come to animal nutrition. And then I'm going to talk about high concentrate versus forage on this. One of the things that we do in our production system is we take calves or yearlings, young animals, and we put them in the feedlot. And we feed them a high concentrate diet to get them to grow very rapidly. And that isn't necessarily the same system that other people use. So I'm just going to call this the high concentrate versus grass, all right? And we hear a lot about grass feeding. There are more producers who are producing grass-fed beef. I always get somebody who's at a meeting and they talk before me and they're like, well, we have doubled the production of grass-fed beef. Well, you went from 2% to 4%. Yes, you did double. very important, and if people want it, they should get it. And one of the things hopefully that we'll do on our field trip is we'll go to Whole Foods. And whether we go to Whole Foods in Austin, which is one of my favorite stores to go to because their bean counter is just incredible. And especially when we go in December, it's at its peak. And they have their dry aged meat in the background. And they have the most variability in different products. It's fun to stand there and watch people come in and shop. So, yeah, I get my bills that way. But anyway, so what happens if we feed concentrate diets where animals grow very rapidly for short periods of time? And it's part of what helps us to produce these younger animals to go to harvest, right? Versus growing on a high roughage-based diet, grass or roughage-based, without feeding high concentrate diet. So marbling. Well, because feeding high concentrate diets increases growth rate, it increases fatness. We get to that fifth fat depot much more rapidly, don't we? So feeding high concentrate diets, big effect. We can get marbling and grass-fed beef. And we actually did a study, and it happened to be that if you put them on really good quality grass, and it's improved pasture, and you do rotation, and you supplement them with some corn, you can take the right genetic type, and you can get really good marbling. But it's very difficult to do 52 weeks out of the year, right? We could do that in the spring, and we could do it in East Texas. We couldn't do that in Uvalde, Texas, okay? But it takes a lot of management and a lot of work. So you can match the genetic type to the production system, and in those periods of time when you have really good quality grass growing, you can get really high average daily gains on those animals, and you can get some marbling, but it's hard to do, okay? And you can do it. So I'm just going to put this as a negative, okay? It's hard to do. They tend to be lower in marbling. And if you go out and sample the grass-fed beef systems, we are working with Nolan Ryan, and they have two different ways that they have a grass feed system. They merchandise their product at HEB. And if you go to HEB, you'll see some variability in the product that's there. Because they basically have two systems. One is a pasture-fed grass-fed system, and the other one is a feedlot-type system where they're giving them a pelleted ration. And they actually have the pelleted ration, and they control the dietary intake and the nutrient content of it. So it's like feeding a high-concentrate diet, but they only have roughage. And so they're feeding for a longer period of time, but they are getting more marbling, and it's very obvious. And so we have a student, a graduate student, who is works with that program we're going to be doing some work with that. Okay. So we tend to not get marbling unless we have really good quality grass, and that's usually for short periods of time. Connective tissue. Connective tissue solubility, we saw that it increases with very rapid growth rates. So while when we measure connective tissue solubility in grass versus grain, as long as they're young, we don't see huge, huge effects. So I'm going to just put a positive here and one negative. It isn't a huge effect, but we do know that feeding high concentrate diets, especially in those first 70 days on feed, when animals are growing really rapidly, that we do see an increase in collagen solubility. And it goes from about 16 to 20%. So that's pretty big from collagen solubility. But again, it's not like 5 versus 20, right? So it's a subtle effect. Contractile state, when we feed high concentrate diets, we get higher levels of subcutaneous fat and heavier weight carcasses. Therefore, they're less susceptible to cold shortening. Doesn't versus grass fed. So I do consulting, and people call and talk to me or email me and ask me questions. And the one thing that I tell every person who's doing grass fed beef is, you've got to blood pit. You probably don't have the ability to do high voltage, but at least do it in the blood pit and do low voltage. Because your animals are more susceptible to cold shock. Because the grass-fed beef tends to produce lighter weight animals that have less fat. So, contractual state, I'm going to put two pluses here and two minuses there, right? A little bit bigger effect than what we're going to find with collagen solubility. What about meat aging? It's been hypothesized that if you have higher rates of growth, which means you're going to have higher rates of protein turnover, you may have lower calprotectin. So I'm just, yeah, David? Subcutaneous fat. So, do calprotectin levels differ in high concentrate fed animals versus grass? And there's been no evidence of that. The meat, as long as it's not cold shortened, seems to age whatever the animals are going to have. So I'm just going to put no effect. So, look at what we have up here so far. There's a lot of different things that we do from a production standpoint to try to improve palatability. That has different effects on different pieces of the puzzle, doesn't it? So far, genetic selection, killing young animals, doing genetic selection, castrating, and feeding high concentrate diets are the things that we need to do to increase marble. To increase collagen solubility, the biggest thing is right here, isn't it? Slaughter them young, and then castrate them. From a contractile state, we know that everything is based on weight and fatness. So the biggest things here is that young animals tend to be those that we feed high concentrate diets that are going to be fatter. And we select for heavier weight animals so that they're less susceptible. We castrate and we harvest heifers and steers because they're going to be less susceptible. And then we feed high concentrate diets to eliminate that or to make that piece a positive piece. From an aging effect, the biggest thing is genetic selection so far, isn't it? So that's kind of putting all that into perspective. The last thing I wanted to talk about, and I have lots of stuff I could talk about. Oh, there we go. Our handling effects. Now, we talked a lot about handling effects in pork. We do know handling effects also affect beef, but ruminants have a different metabolism and are less susceptible to short-term stress. They still can be if things go haywire. But tend to not be. We have more problems with long-term stress. And Dr. Hale, about a month ago, sent all of us pictures and said, people who think dark cutters aren't still a reality haven't been at the retail meat case for a while. Because in the retail meat case, he just took some pictures of there's some dark cutting beef along with some regular broadhead. So we do have an incidence of dark cutting. And that long-term, it's a long-term stress issue. And then we have blood splash. Those are the two things that we deal with handling. And so if we look at this handling effect, marbling, connective tissue, contractile state, or aging, no, but it does affect color and visual appearance. So I'm just gonna put visual up here. Just that I don't want you to think that handling isn't important, right? And it's going to cause DFD and beef, and then we have blood splash, right? Those are the two main issues, and those don't really affect the palatability puzzle, but it affects the visual impression. Okay, so when I go to other countries and talk about beef production, if I'm in Korea or Japan, I'm there. our system produces high quality beef. And if I am in Europe or South Africa, they're the main ones, Australia or South America, Central America, what I'm talking about is the U.S. system differs, or how we manage quality in the U.S. is we harvest young animals, we do a lot of genetic selection, and we do not produce bulls, but we produce steers and heifers, and we have technology so that heifers will not cycle, so that we don't have calves, which are, we don't want heifers pregnant in the feedlot. That's why when at Sioux Carney, seeing the bulls and heifers in the same pen, you know, I started almost hyperventilating. And then we feed high concentrate diets. And then we worry about handling so that we reduce long-term stress, and we have put a lot of money into handling systems for exsanguination to reduce blood supply. So that's a great story to tell. But we also do things from after that animal has come to harvest. Because I always say, those are the things that you can control in the live animal. But then they get delivered to the packing plant. And then what can we do? What can we do to impact those four pieces of the palatability puzzle? So, I pulled up the same slides. I'm sorry. I need to take my glasses off to pay attention to what I'm doing. Okay. I thought I had the other one up. Here's the post-harvest. Okay. So post-harvest, the things that I want to talk about here are electrical stimulation, blade tenderization, and aging. And isn't it interesting, those are the things, that we talked about in the lab, and that you experienced in the lab. Oh, postmortem factors, all right, we're set to go here. And there are some other things, but electrical stimulation. I think you all have seen electrical stimulation 307. It's a very important part of our industry. There are two types of electrical stimulation. There's low voltage in the blood pit, and then there's high voltage coming at some point, usually prior to splitting the carcass, because you don't want a high voltage, a split carcass. Done that many times for experiments, and you can bounce them off the rail. They bounce a lot. Okay. But we usually do that prior to splitting the carcass. And what we're doing here with electrical stimulation is we're using up ATP. That's the whole reason. We're just driving rigor faster. It's very important because we want to chill our carcasses as fast as possible. A lot of that's due to safety. We don't, by chilling them rapidly, we're going to have less microbial growth. And also, the faster you chill them, and if you chill them with water, you're going to lose less moisture and less weight. And you want to move that product through the plant, right? It's pounds per hour, pounds per hour, pounds per hour. So, ES is going to... whether low voltage is done in the blood pit, it's going to help exsanguination, we've talked about in the past, but it's going to really start that rigor process. It's going to get them into onset much, much faster. So that when they come out of the blood pit, you know, they're already out of delay and into onset. And that way, we want the pHs to be, if we can, at least less than 6 by 3 hours. Okay. 3 hours post-exsanguination. Because the carcass isn't ever going to chill. You're not going to have any problems with cold shortening. So ES does a lot for us for color. And I put this picture up. This is called, they call this heat ring, two-toning. You see this darker color? This is actually the same carcass, but different sides, one ES, one non-ES. And this really isn't heat ring. This is really cold ring. And the pH here is higher than the pH here, because this chilled more rapidly and rigor stopped. Because the other thing that could stop those enzymes involved in rigor, not only pH, remember as the pH drops, but temperature. They don't work when it gets cold. So they stop. And you can physically take a pH probe, and this will be a higher pH than it will be in the center. Or if you get two-toning where you have a light center, here it is. Right here, this is going to be a lower pH than out here. So this doesn't really have heat, what they call, used to call heat ring, but this has two-toning, and it's due also to chilling. So you can reduce those effects just by ESing, because what you're doing is you're using up, you're making the muscles work. And when I went to Sukarni, and they said, yes, we have ES at the blood pit and prior to going at the cooler, I said, okay, I want to go see it. Do you know what voltage, you know, how much time, what are your cycles? And they looked at me like, we'll have to get back to you on that one. And went to the blood pit, and I'm like, where's your ES? Like, well, did you see the carcass went like this? I'm like, it didn't go like this. And I timed it, and it was 6 seconds. I'm like, okay, no cycling. Because you have to do this to use up ATP. You can use some ATP up like this, but you need to work. You have to contract, relax, because those myosin heads, when they release, and I gave a little lecture on it, the myosin heads can't release until they have ATP. So you're going to use up more ATP by cycling versus one contraction. I mean, you're still using up some ATP, but so we took a fence charger, because it cycles, and they took a video of the cycling carcasses, and they were flopping around all over the place. It was great. And whoa! And their pHs, their 3-hour pHs, were at least close to 6. Had some other problems, but anyway, at least we drove it, right? And what it's doing, we can see marbling better because it makes the color more even, right? It doesn't increase marbling. It just makes it the color more even so we can see marbling. Connective tissue, no effect. It's not going to do anything to connective tissue. Contractile state, it's going to have a huge effect on it. It's going to eliminate it. And the nice thing about electrical stimulation is that it doesn't hurt those that don't need it, but it helps those that do. Usually you have something that those that don't need it, you apply it and it makes them worse, right? But ES is a win-win. It just removes the variability in those other ones. Does it help aging? I'm gonna put a positive there, because if it can eliminate cold shortening, then aging will happen normally, because we don't have those shorter cycles. So, ES, you know, when I talk about, and I've gotten to travel the world, given the talk up on the board, okay? And it's like, you can feed the cattle, you can castrate the cattle, you can genetically select them, you can keep them young, you can handle them right, and then once they get there, don't mess that up, ES them, right? Just remove the effect of contractile state. Just get it out of the puzzle. Because we really didn't do a whole lot for contractile state before that. Blade tenderization. This is an age-old technology. This is not new. It's been around since before I wanted to be a meat scientist, okay? And this is using blades. And did the hand blade tenderization? Mm-hmm. And did you guys get to blade tenderize?
Blood Monday did. It's this week. So.
Oh, that's right. This week. So those of you today need to like tenderize. And it doesn't really, it does, the needles poke down in. And what they mainly do is they affect the contractile state right here. And it's going to have no effect on marbling because it's not going to give us more marbling. If we have cold shortening, because there, it's not only poking holes down in the meat that poke through the paramecium and endomecium, but it's also poking through the muscle fibers. But it's not so rigorous that we change the shape of the muscle. So I'm going to put a positive effect there. Aging, we only do blade tenderization after aging, all right? After aging. Because we are disrupting the muscle cell, we are going to have slightly more purge, and we have the opportunity potentially to drive some microorganisms to the inside, even though it's pretty, it's not very substantial in meat today, and it's going, we are going to have a little bit more purge than that, so you do it after aging. Last piece of the puzzle, aging. Yeah, I am going to get to all of them. And of course, aging is 14 days refrigerated temperatures, not frozen, right? It's not going to affect marbling. It's not going to affect connective tissue unless you do it so long that it'll have some effect. It's not going to really affect contractile state. But it's going to have a big effect down here. So those are the things from a practical standpoint that we do in our industry. I have a couple other things. We can grind. We know we do that for meat that is really tough. Plant enzymes are used. You're using some plant enzymes in lab, so those can be used. Papain is the one that's the easiest to control. And then we can also enhance. We do add water, salt, and phosphate to meat to get it to add flavor. Also some antimicrobials. We're not going to really talk about that. But I want to just summarize. What do I want you to know for the test? I want you to be able to recreate or discuss each one of these issues. So in our industry, if we feed animals, if we feed them high concentrate diets and harvest them when they're young, which we do, using animals that we've had genetic selection for tenderness and for marbling, we make sure we castrate them, make sure the heifers don't have calves, we handle them right, and then we take them to the plant, we ES them, we age the meat, and then we blade tenderize. We do an awful lot. You can see how we affect each of those four pieces of the puzzle. And not each one of those affects all pieces, does it? But it has some effect. By the time we end up, we have some strong positives here, some strong positives here, some positives here, and some positives there. But they're not all the same factor that's affecting it, right? They all add up. And that's how we control the puzzle. And then we can ruin it all by not cooking it correctly. That's for another time. All right. So thank you very much. I've enjoyed having you. And so the test, how do you feel about the test? It'll be short answer, essay most of them. No identified. And on this part, if you can recreate what's up on the board, you can answer any part of that. All right? Yeah. See, and I put it like that because by the time I put it up on the board, it all makes more sense, right? And the positives and the negatives. And you can explain it like I did on the board, and it will be fine.
So if we make that chart somewhere on the paper, we get 100, right?
Well, you'll have to explain it. I can't quite say that. Well, it's only 20 points on the test, so. show you frame size differences within a litter.
I'm so excited.
Okay.
So you're going to distract us on test day.
I'm going to let you can only see them after you finish your test.
Okay.
And I will bring you some cookies.